It's rolling if you want to switch.
Ed Begley here, test, test, test.
Thanks, guys. One more time.
Ed Begley, test.
Level seems fine.
Level seems fine, very good.
So we're talking about the Indonesian rainforest.
Great.
And the importance of rainforest to medicine, food, air, water.
Importance of the rainforest what?
To the whole bioecosystem of
yes.
Air, food, water,
yep.
Medicine, the vitality and the importance of it.
I'm ready.
And we're rolling, so you can start anytime and we'll just cut off.
Hi, my name is Ed Begley Jr. and I'm an environmental activist and I've been trying to live a sustainable life since 1970. And we're at a very interesting point in our history. We're like fish who started to nibble at the controls in an aquarium without any real idea of the consequences. And we're starting to affect our climate, we're starting to affect many ecosystems, and nowhere is it more evident than in places like Indonesia where we're losing the rainforest and the cost for that. Of losing that vital part of the lungs of the planet. It deals with our air, our water, our endangered species. The orangutans are severely threatened there in the Indonesian rainforest because of the way they're cutting down the rainforest to put up palm oil plantations. And so we have a real challenge. We have to do something. We have to do everything we can to make a difference. And what do we do about that? We get people involved, we get people active, we stop buying palm oil, or certainly make sure we get certified palm oil that's not part of Indonesian rainforest ecosystems, and make a change. But we simply can't continue as we have been, destroying the lungs of the planet for short-term gain. And there's ways to do that. There's wonderful groups that are doing it. So I'm very proud to be associated with this organization, my dear friend Kurt Kelly. We're trying to make a change for the better in the Indonesian rainforest and throughout the world. So thank you so much, Ed Begley Jr. Do what you can to help.
Camera 3 on his thoughts. We have nearly 150 species about to be extinct in the next 1 to 5 years. True fact, there is only one male rhino left on the planet. He's in captivity, being saved in a zoo in hopes he might reproduce. If he doesn't, we will lose rhinos in the next few years.
Is that a black or a white rhino?
I think it's white.
Yeah.
And it's the last one on the planet. There's only 600 jaguars left on the planet. Because I'm on the Black Jaguar Foundation. We're about to lose 150 species.
What's the name of your group again?
This particular one is called Morassus. Rainforest Should Not Die. That's the name of the film.
Great.
So it's all shot in Morassus in Indonesia on the island where the rainforests are at.
Great.
And on the Dropbox she sent you, you can see 45 minutes of the orangutans and all the stuff you just talked about. The palm oil, that's all part of it. So you're right. On. You're spot on. But maybe you want to talk about the amount of species being lost that we can never get back. And new study by Berkeley, 1 to 10 years, if we don't stop this, we can never reverse it, and it will definitely bring down the bioecosystem, and they don't know how yet. New study out.
Ready to talk. Is we still rolling?
I've never stopped.
Great.
We're getting all of this.
You know, we have to try to appreciate that extinction is forever. We've lost so many plant and animal species since the Industrial Revolution, and it's something that we have to reckon with. We can't continue on this path for our own well-being, even if you don't value the many different species in the web of life. You know, it's like we're in an airplane and we're all together flying up at 31,000 feet, and at some point, you lose a rivet, and you lose another rivet, and you lose another rivet from that airplane. At some point, that airplane ceases to fly, and all these many species in the ecosystem are what is keeping us all aloft. We are getting clean water and clean food and clean air from the many plant and animal species that are part of the web of life. We have to recognize this. You know, the white rhino, there's one male, I believe, left in captivity. When that's gone, that's the end of the white rhino species. Many other species. There's a few hundred jaguars left in the wild. You know, there's a wonderful movie that I just saw called Racing Extinction, and it talks about the amount of plant and animal species lost every day in the world. And it's something we have to all recognize and be part of the solution, because we've all been part of the problem. We've all benefited from the many products that we use and the many different industrial processes and the energy that we generate and the fuel that we drill for and the minerals that we drill for and the trees that we cut down for forest products. We've all been part of that. So let's, now that we've been part of the problem, let's be part of the solution and try to find other ways. There's ways to live sustainability. There's ways to get different kinds of oil to cook with and make products out of without taking down rainforest. There's ways to get energy without drilling for oil in the Gulf and causing the Deepwater Horizon spill. There's ways to get energy without drilling and digging for coal in the areas of Pennsylvania and West Virginia. There's other ways, and I know they work because I've been doing them since 1970, living sustainably, and then from 1990 I've been living on solar power and living a very energy efficient lifestyle. So there's ways to do this. There's ways to change your diet that are better for the planet. There's ways to change your lifestyle, your energy use, your modes of transportation, and some of it costs more, but some of it is very inexpensive. How much does it cost to ride a bicycle, if weather and fitness permit, or take public transportation if it's available near you? These things are cheaper than the norm. Do what you can. It's all connected to Indonesia. It's connected to the rainforest of Brazil. It's connected to every part of the world. Our consumption has an effect in remote parts of the world, and indeed it has an effect in other people in this very city. So make a change today, help out this wonderful organization, and thank you for allowing me to be part of it.
Quick questions, your thoughts on fracking?
You know, there are ways to get methane out of the ground. One day we'll stop using methane taken out of the ground from fossil fuels, but certainly for now there's ways to get methane without fracking. And more importantly, there's ways to get methane that does not come from crude oil or from out of the ground in a normal sense. You can get methane from landfills, and you can get it from dairy farms and other areas where there's cattle. There's something called biomethane, or RNG, renewable natural gas. So we can supply a lot of our needs without fracking, without that kind of normal fossil fuel use. Methane, CH4, is a very potent greenhouse gas. So you're doing two things if you're using biomethane. You're keeping that methane from going and doing a worse job up in the atmosphere by being emitted from the landfill or the dairy operation. And then you're doing another thing. You're eliminating the cause for fracking by substituting it with something called biomethane. So fracking does not have to be. A lot of these other energy sources do not have to be. There's ways to get our energy from solar, wind, biomethane, biodiesel, ethanol, and not just made from corn, ethanol made from the corn stalk, not the corn cob itself that people can eat. You can make ethanol from plant waste. So there's lots of ways that are inexpensive and accessible and available today.
What do you think about the United States government voting this fall to deregulate all scientific data from the EPA? Is that a smart move?
The way that this current Congress has dealt with the EPA is just nothing short of shameful. They've defunded them, they've hamstrung them, they've vilified them, they've, you know, claimed that they've made the country a worse place to live in. We had rivers catching fire in 1969. An environmental radical by the name of Richard Nixon signed the Clean Water Act and the Clean Air Act. We now have cleaner air in LA from 1970, even though we have four times the cars and millions more people. The air is not dirtier in LA from 1970. It is much cleaner now, even with all those people in additional cars. Why? Because all the stuff that we hoped would work did work. Catalytic converters on cars, combined cycle gas turbines, spray paint booths, all these things that we did that were good for the environment were also good for the economy. So we can have a successful economic outlook, and we can do it with a lot less damage to the environment. I've been saying for years, capitalism is a great idea. We ought to try it. By that I mean to really value the capital of the trees in Indonesia standing. They have value standing. To value the many other plant and animal species that have value to us left alone. Trees prevent soil erosion, produce oxygen, take in CO2, retain groundwater. A tree standing has tremendous value. It's not just valuable once you cut it up and make it into 2x4s and plywood. So capitalism is a good thing we ought to really try and value our natural capital, which is our web of life, our ecosystem around us.
So are you in favor that the EPA is actually, all the advisors on the EPA who decide who should get fined or not, should those be people from the oil and gas companies who the US government has appointed, or is there an inherent conflict possibly?
There's many good people, and I know them, in the EPA, the national EPA and the California EPA, wonderful people are doing a good job to protect the environment. There are other people that have other agendas in those organizations, in that organization and in others, that, you know, there's been a revolving door between industry and the, you know, the Department of Agriculture and the EPA for many years. People who should be protecting plant and animal species, you know, at the EPA and at the Department of Agriculture have had kind of a cozy relationship with industry for years. So I don't know that that's in our best interest. Our best interest, I think, is to protect the commons, the common air, the common water, the common land that we all value. You can do what you want with your personal property, but you can't destroy the commons. You can't compromise the common land, air, and water that we all depend on. And that's very old law in this country and throughout the world.
So, for people who don't have celebrity or political influence, I'm Joe Sixpackadones, I'm a normal guy. How can I help make a difference in the world today? Empower me.
You can make a big difference as a normal individual by voting. By that I mean voting on election day, and there's other important times that you vote. You vote with your emails, your cards, your letters, your family.